Muy buenos días a todas.
I should like to wish all delegations an extremely good day, distinguished delegates. I'd like to welcome you to what is our last working day in this session. The ninth plenary meeting of the substantive session of the UN conference to negotiate a legally binding instrument prohibiting nuclear weapons leading towards their total elimination is called to order. We shall now look at topic three. The conference will begin its consideration then of institutional arrangements under sub-item B of agenda item 8. We have a large number of delegations, a long list of those who have put their names down to take the floor, so I'm sure that we shall have a very useful exchange of views. First of all, we have the delegation of Antigua and Barbuda on behalf of the Caribbean community.
Good morning, Madam President. Thank you for giving me the floor. I have the honor to speak on behalf of the 14 members of the Caribbean community, CARICOM. The case for the nuclear weapons ban treaty has been driven by serious concerns regarding the humanitarian consequences of nuclear detonations. As a result, CARICOM delegations call for the treaty's institutional arrangements to ensure all states' parties provide for international cooperation and assistance to comply with positive obligations arising from the treaty. These positive obligations include environmental remediation, risk education, victim survivor assistance, and stockpile destruction. The treaty's institutional arrangements should further include obligations on states to promote universalization of the treaty and discourage violations of its norms. National measures to implement the treaty's obligations could include penal sanctions to prevent and suppress violations of the treaty and its norms. Madam President, we believe that the contribution of civil society has been instrumental in this process and should be included in the treaty as instrumental in applying and implementing the treaty, as well as in raising awareness regarding the humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons. Additionally, the member states of CARICOM are of the opinion that the treaty should establish a mechanism that will facilitate the treaty's effective implementation and universalization. This mechanism will be responsible for overseeing the operation of the treaty, to ensure compliance, to manage follow-up steps, and to provide a forum for consultation and cooperation among states' parties. This mechanism will also be charged with managing and organizing regular conferences of states' parties with the support of the UN. In closing, and in keeping with our position to avoid duplication of roles and resources and to strengthen the broader nuclear disarmament mechanism, it is envisaged that related bodies, including the IAEA, could be invited to support the established mechanism. I thank you.
Le agradezco mucho a la distinguida.
I should like to thank the distinguished delegate of Antigua and Barbuda for that, speaking on behalf of the CARICOM. Now, Chile has the floor. Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I shall endeavor to be brief. I believe that it is important for us here to remember the fact that by means of this treaty, we are opening up new avenues for the management of the peace and security pillar within the UN system and within the context of multilateral diplomacy. I say this because certain of the proposals that I shall be putting forward on the part of my country might appear rather curious, but I believe that they are of great importance. in this treaty, we need an executive secretariat. I don't know whether executive secretariat would be the right terminology for this, but what is important is the concept that there be a body which can deal with administration from the point of view of a secretariat when it comes to the whole treaty process. So I come back once again to this concept of the treaty as being a process, that is, a global product, a global public asset, which will develop over time, which will grow, and the impact of which will increase ever more on the peace and security pillar in the multilateral system. And for the treaty to grow in this manner, and so that it really is revolutionary in the very best meaning of that term, the states parties to this treaty need to establish two alliances, two partnerships, the first with civil society, and that's already in existence. The second is with the academic world. So to this end, outreach, promotional activities aimed at universalization, aimed at consciousness raising in public opinion on this treaty, these will require very active interaction and very active planning for joint action on the part of civil society. I think that that has to fit in somewhere. I don't know whether the preamble will be the best place. It would be wonderful were we to be able to incorporate something of this sort in the operational articles of the treaty. And then reference could be made. There's a reason that's very simple to this. If we really want the treaty to meet its end of eliminating nuclear weapons, we're going to have to win over lots of people. And if we're going to do that, we've got to start with young people, with students. So therefore, the partnership with the academic world is very important here. When the time comes, this delegation will put forward a text to deal with this. As I say, it should be amongst the executive articles, as it were, otherwise in the preamble. Now, when it comes to the verification formula, at present, given the juncture of our discussions here, and we come with an open mind, we're flexible, we have no preconceived ideas, so that we can reach an agreement with other delegations and with civil society and the academic world to come up with the best formula. And so we think what Professor Gautam Mutasana of the CNS suggested yesterday, he's a member of our delegation as well, this is the best formula to date, South Africa plus. Now, what does this mean? In this model, accession occurs only once those states which possess nuclear weapons have done away with their arsenals, the policies and programs associated with those nuclear weapons as well. Now, that's very important. This would spare us the extremely tedious negotiation on elimination and verification clauses. So those states which wish to be party to the treaty have to prove the absence of arms and nuclear programs by means of accepting broad safeguards, which we all have with the IA, but also the additional protocol. Chile has said this, and I myself voiced this in the IA conference in Vienna. The protocol must be part and parcel of the standard mechanism of verification that the body has. And I think this also has to be incorporated in our text. That's all I'll say for now, Madam Chairman. I will spare you further thoughts. Thank you.
Distinguido delegado de Chile.
Thank you very much, the delegation of Chile. The floor now goes to the delegation of Mexico. Thank you very much. As we indicated, Madam, in yesterday's informal meeting, the discussion on institutional arrangements and other provisions provides us with an opportunity in addition to discussing administrative and additional matters in the strict sense of the term, it provides us with an opportunity to find solutions to a series of complex issues which were identified in the preceding two sessions, such as, for example, verification and elimination. So then, regarding this issue, my delegation believes that the following elements should be considered when drafting the treaty. In order to promote the universalization of the convention, the periodical examination of the state of implementation of the treaty, and in order to provide a space for decision-making by the states parties, we believe that there should be an annual meeting on the part of the states parties. There should be a determination of a president, chair of this meeting of the states parties, perhaps for a year. And inter alia, this meeting of the states parties should have the power to convene, if relevant, review conferences. The obligation to submit initial and annual reports on national implementation could be dealt with by means of compliance and monitoring. Compliance with obligations, or what certain delegations have dubbed verification of compliance of the obligations of the original parties to the treaty. We talked yesterday of two types of verification. Verification of elimination by those possessing nuclear weapons, but also verification regarding compliance with our obligations. So therefore, we believe that initial reports as well as annual reports will prove necessary. Now, to further the purpose of the convention, it would be appropriate to have a unit for the support of the implementation of the treaty. However, in order to avoid additional and excessive financial burden on the parties, my delegation believes that the institutional arrangements should be as slender as possible and should take into account existing synergies, such as with the disarmament office, or, if this proves agreeable, this unit could indeed be incorporated in the ODA. Given that the convention will be negotiated under the aegis of the UN, the Secretary General would be the depository of the treaty. The treaty should include mechanisms for the entry into force and also provisions for rescinding the treaty provisions or withdrawing from it. My delegation believes here that we should consider a treaty being intimately related with international humanitarian law, and the number of ratifications for its entry into force should not be very high there. 30 ratifications would be sufficient. We need here to consider the failed treaty for the complete prohibition of nuclear tests, and therefore avoid requirements which hamper entry into force, such as the requirement for ratification by a particular state or group of states in particular. When it comes to withdrawing from the treaty, rescinding it, we believe that an ad hoc provision for this should be included. And were it not to be so, there would be automatic implementation of the provisions in the Vienna Convention on Treaty Law, which is very low in terms of where the standard is set. Therefore, Mexico proposes there should be two requirements for withdrawing from the treaty. One, the impossibility of doing this during armed conflict, and two, that a state party may notify a withdrawal only once 15 years had gone by from the entry into force and accession by the state concerned. Given the nature of the convention, we believe that there should be no reservations, and also that the period of the treaty should be indefinite. When it comes to the discussion on whether or not there should be a definition of a nuclear weapon included, my delegation does not believe it is a sine qua non for the prohibition treaty to be effective or useful. I think it's appropriate here to recall that the cornerstone of the non-proliferation and nuclear disarmament treaty does not have a definition of a nuclear weapon, and it still remains an extremely useful and important instrument. The treaty should be inclusive as an instrument and not discriminatory. Here, the prohibition treaty should remain open to states, parties, and non-parties of the NTP, and states both possessing and not possessing nuclear weapons in their national arsenals. All states, parties would have this be deemed to be of the same category for the purposes of this legal instrument. In order to open the possibility for states with nuclear weapons comply with the treaty, we could have two options. Firstly, eliminating all nuclear weapons stockpiles by means of ratification or accession to the treaty, and then secondly, drawing up a plan for the elimination of all nuclear weapons to be implemented in, let's say, 15 years, together with a proposal for an international verification mechanism to ensure due implementation. Such a plan should be submitted to the parties at least 6 months prior to a meeting of the states' parties, a meeting to which approval of this proposal for such a mechanism and plan for elimination would be submitted. Regarding the international verification mechanism, there are two options that could be put forward. Being subject to verification under the IAEA, and then presenting a mechanism for international verifications that would be ad hoc to be submitted to the consideration and approval of the parties. The treaty should be open to the possibility that any additional protocols deemed necessary by the parties could be added to it. I referred to this yesterday. We believe that certain additions might prove necessary. Then, sir, I'd just like to say something else that doesn't necessarily pertain to institutional arrangements. I'm referring here to the issue of assistance for victims. I want to state totally clearly that Mexico, with the greatest of firmness, supports the right to compensation and redress for victims of nuclear tests. But we are not sure, we're not clear as to how such a law or right would be implemented, and when it comes to this treaty, how it would be put into effect, as some delegations have indicated. Perhaps, madam, those states whose citizens, alas, are victims, could identify specific measures for us that could become norms to be incorporated either in this or in another instrument or mechanism where the issue of victim compensation could be dealt with. We believe that this is a right, an entitlement. It's just a question of how it should be implemented, whether it should be enshrined in this instrument or another one. Thank you very much. I should like to thank the distinguished delegate of Mexico, and I now give the floor to the delegation of Sweden.
Thank you, Madam President. Like for other treaties, we believe that there should be some kind of institutional arrangements. They should be efficient and cost-effective. A small ISU, Implementation Support Unit, could be established. We foresee annual short meetings of state parties and reasonably short review conferences every 5th year. State parties should report on the implementation of their commitments to these meetings. The treaty should be of indefinite duration. It should be possible for a state party to withdraw from the treaty, but only after a meeting of state parties. However, when all the nuclear weapon states are parties to the treaty, a review or amendment conference could be convened, deciding that it should no longer be possible to withdraw from the treaty.
The Secretary General should be the depository of the treaty. Regarding the entry into force provision, we believe that it could occur when 80 states have ratified the treaty. Based on the number of states that supported the resolution in the General Assembly, the number of member states of the United Nations, and the number necessary to make the treaty legitimate. Madam Chair, before ending, I would really like to thank you for this week. I think our week has been marked by seriousness, respect, and substance. And the interactive session proved to be very useful. And I believe that no one outside this room who are not participating in the negotiations can say anything but that this week's negotiation was really a serious one. And I do look forward to our continuation in July. Thank you, Madam.
Le agradezco mucho a...
My thanks go to Ambassador Valdés for those words, your kind words indeed, and your on this week of the conference. The delegation of Brazil now has the floor.
Madam President, we are now embarking upon the last section of this conference. It is dedicated to the institutional arrangements for the Nuclear Weapons Ban Treaty. During this week, we had fruitful discussions on the treaty's substance. The question we should ask ourselves now is what would be the most suitable institutional frame for the treaty, as well as the contents of provisions regarding accession, reservation, entry into force, withdrawal, and the possible need for secretariat. The treaty's effectiveness and the level of support will hinge to a great extent on those issues. They should merit, therefore, our careful scrutiny. Madam President, at the very first session of the open-ended working group taking forward multilateral nuclear disarmament negotiations held in Geneva last year, Brazil submitted in its national capacity the document A/AC.286/Working Paper 10 on possible elements for a nuclear weapons ban treaty. On that occasion, we proposed a hybrid arrangement. It differs from both a standalone instrument and a comprehensive convention. The former would be a treaty focused almost exclusively on core prohibitions, whereas the latter would address all issues pertaining to nuclear weapons, such as the fundamental prohibitions and obligations of states, a verification regime for nuclear weapons, the elimination of nuclear arsenals and measures to ensure irreversibility of fissile materials used for military purposes. A hybrid agreement comprises either a set of mutually reinforcing instruments dealing progressively with various aspects of the nuclear disarmament process, or a main prohibition agreement followed by subsidiary agreements or protocols thereto. Under ideal circumstances, a comprehensive convention would be undoubtedly the best option, since all issues could be dealt with in a single stroke. But in view of the nuclear weapons states and allied countries' current reservations about a ban treaty, Brazil deems the notion of a hybrid arrangement to be the most viable option on the following grounds. The effects of a nuclear weapons ban treaty, whatever its format, will be first and foremost a political and legal nature, and it will have a great impact in shaping and driving the disarmament agenda. By setting out a clear commitment and parameters regarding further initiatives for the actual elimination of nuclear weapons, bearing in mind nuclear arms possessing states, it translates into legally binding action the so far elusive obligation contained in Article 6 of the NPT. Secondly, such an agreement will allow for flexibility for confidence building measures with a view to strengthening its support base. This approach should provide for smooth transition from the nuclear status quo to nuclear disarmament, taking into account the concerns of all states simultaneously. Madam President, let me express our views on accession. Brazil is of the opinion that the prior destruction or dismantling of all stockpiles should not be a requirement for accession. In other words, the treaty should envisage the possibility of accession before complete stockpile destruction. Of course, in this case, the applicant would be required to submit to the treaty party's consideration a detailed plan on how it will carry out the obligation to eliminate its stockpiles. Brazil favors this approach based on the positive experience of the Treaty of Tlatelolco. Article 29 of the treaty defines the requirements for entry into force of the treaty for an individual ratifying state, but also grants states the right to waive those requirements, wholly or in part, at the time of ratification or subsequently. Those requirements were the ratification by all states within the area of application of the treaty. The ratification by all powers possessing nuclear weapons of a specific protocol addressed to them. The ratification by all states having de jure or de facto international responsibility for territories situated in the area of application of the treaty, of protocols specifically addressing their situation, and the conclusion of agreements on the application of the safeguard system of the IAEA. As an analogy, one could think of a flexible and yet strong arrangement whereby, in order to accede to the future treaty, states possessing nuclear weapons would have to fulfill certain requirements on the subsequent elaboration of disarmament obligations and arrangements. These arrangements would be necessary to ensure that they are going to eliminate their nuclear arsenals in accordance with well-established timelines in an irreversible, transparent, and verifiable manner. Brazil believes that an arrangement along those lines would promote adherence to the treaty, thereby pushing forward the goal of its universalization. Madam President, in order to reaffirm the complementarity that exists between the future treaty and other cornerstones of the nuclear disarmament and non-proliferation regime, such as the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, its text should clearly state that nothing in the treaty should be interpreted as in any way limiting or detracting from the rights and obligations relating to the use of nuclear energy for peaceful purposes. Nuclear disarmament and nuclear non-proliferation under the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, the Antarctic Treaty, the Outer Space Treaty, and the treaties establishing nuclear weapon-free zones. In light of the inherent humanitarian character of the future treaty, it is important to ensure that its articles shall not be subject to reservations. Moreover, in order to ensure its timely entry into force, it should have a quantitative requisite in this regard. Entry into force should not depend on the ratification of specific states. Brazil believes it would be useful for the implementation of the future treaty that the instrument to be assessed through periodical review conferences, which could at first focus on promoting the universalization of the treaty. Ideally, convening review conferences every 5 years could be considered. In addition, we highlight the importance of allowing for the convening of extraordinary sessions, including with a view to negotiating complementary instruments to the treaty, providing a general plan for destruction of nuclear arsenals, and measures related to a non-discriminatory verification regime. Any state party should be entitled to propose amendments to the treaty, the text of which should be submitted to the Secretary General of the United Nations, who should promptly circulate it to all parties. The decision to take up the proposal should be made by a majority of the state's parties present and voting at the next review conference of the banned treaty. The adoption of an amendment at a meeting of the review conference on which consensus cannot be reached shall require a two-thirds majority of states' parties. A provision on withdrawal should include strong language and establish specific criteria compatible with the importance of the object of the treaty. We could take Article 10 of the NPT as a basis, but seek also to reflect the particular characteristics of the future treaty, which aims at achieving and maintaining a world free of nuclear weapons. Last but not least, Brazil does not envisage the need for the establishment of a permanent secretariat. as the review conferences could count on UNODA's assistance and support for that purpose. Thank you.
Agradezco al distinguido representante.
I should like to thank the distinguished representative of Brazil. Now the delegation of Algeria has the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. At the outset, allow me to express the deep thanks and gratitude of the Algerian delegation for the excellent manner in which you are conducting our deliberations, and my thanks to all the members of the Secretariat of the Conference for their participation in the success of our meeting. Madam, Mr. Chairman, my delegation is of the view that the institutional arrangements must be considered carefully, which will reflect its importance for the future instrument to ban nuclear weapons on one side, and on the other side, the role that to which the international community aspires through the full implementation of this instrument. The importance of the institutional matters is that it facilitates the application of all the provisions that we will adopt in order to avoid any difficulties or problems that will make it difficult to realize the objectives behind this instrument. Thus, my delegation wishes to emphasize the following problems. First, the Executive Secretariat of the future instrument or agreement must have solid institutions and organs that will conduct coordination with other international instruments on weapons of mass destruction. Pending the entry into force of this agreement, it is important to think of the global institution to which will manage this secretariat, the executive secretariat, be that the IAEA or the organization of the CTBT or a hybrid institution that has relations with the relevant international organizations. In this, we can benefit from the experiences and successful experiences of the organizations in the nuclear-free zones in Africa, Latin America, the Caribbean, Central Asia, and Southeast Asia, and the South Pacific. Three, this instrument should be considered as complementary to other instruments regarding disarmament, especially as regards the implementation of the provisions of those agreements and conventions. Four, we must benefit from the experiences relating to the mechanisms of verification and monitoring included in the other relevant international agreements, conventions, and instruments. Fifth, we have to make the entry into force of this agreement a simple one and to avoid the obstacles that have made it very difficult for the CBTB to enter into force since its adoption in 1996. Six, the future instrument must be an instrument for nuclear irreversible nuclear disarmament so that it will not allow any reservations, whatever their nature may be. And in order to implement the principle of irreversibility in conventions, the instrument must be a permanent that it remains valid signed by. Seven, the instrument must include provisions related to the commitments of obligations of the member of the state parties to take necessary measures like the legislation of legislations and criminal laws that punish any activities that run contrary to the provisions of this instrument, be that carried by individuals or an agency or is in a region that is within its jurisdiction or control. Eight, This instrument must strengthen the activities relating to international and regional cooperation, be that between the state parties or between these states and international and relevant international and regional organizations, in order to facilitate the implementation of provisions at the national level, and it will also, it should also strengthen the measures relating to confidence building and transparency. Nine, the instrument must stipulate the provisions for the review conferences in order to guarantee the implementation of its objectives, taking into consideration the develop the scientific and technological developments, and holding periodical meetings for the state parties in order to exchange information, to consider the obstacles and difficulties regarding the implementation of the provisions of the instrument, allowing for a wide participation for international and relevant international and regional organizations, as well as the organizations of the civil society. And last 10, in view of the nature of this agreement or instrument and the obligations that will devolve from it, designating the UN Secretary General as the depositary for this future instrument is in our view, the best option. Sir, we thank you for the floor.
I thank the distinguished representative of Algeria. I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of Philippines.
Madam President, the Philippines wishes to add its voice to the call by other like-minded member states for a time-bound, irreversible, and verifiable nuclear disarmament. As expressed in our statement during the high-level exchange of views last Monday, our work for the succeeding days is the fulfillment of a decades-long commitment under the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons. It is important for us to ensure, therefore, that mechanisms are in place for the treaty to fulfill its objectives. My delegation stresses the importance of a robust and stable institutional framework to support the treaty's objectives. In this regard, we wish to put forward the following elements which my delegation hopes to see included in the zero draft. The Philippines supports the inclusion of language which defines the treaty's relationship with other international institutions in the existing global nuclear security architecture, such as the International Atomic Energy Agency, the Preparatory Commission of the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty Organization, the Treaty on the Non-Proliferation of Nuclear Weapons, and the Nuclear Weapons Free Zones. The Philippines is of the view that the treaty must have a simple provision on the entry into force, stipulating that it will become a binding international law as soon as a certain number of states have ratified it. Thus, we propose a reasonable threshold number for the entry into force of the treaty. The treaty should provide for a conference of states parties review conference and meetings to be convened periodically after the treaty's entry into force, and that the frequency and duration of future meetings be decided by the first such conference. The Philippines recognizes the importance of a dispute settlement mechanism between states, and a provision on such should be included in the treaty. In order to create an environment that is inclusive to all member states of the United Nations, the Philippines supports the inclusion of an amendment provision to the treaty with the condition that amendments must be approved by at least two-thirds of the states' parties to the treaty. The treaty should also be clear about pathways for the accession of other parties, including nuclear weapons states. This language should indicate mechanisms by which state parties could engage nuclear weapons states in discussions on the time frame and process for the time-bound and irreversible elimination of nuclear weapons and stockpiles. The Philippines likewise supports the establishment of an adequately staffed treaty secretariat with clearly defined roles, which will, inter alia, assist state parties in the implementation of the treaty, facilitate the conference of state parties, and facilitate technical assistance and capacity building by matching provider and recipient states. Finally, the treaty must have a provision to assist states in fully implementing the obligations that are to be included in this treaty. Our prohibition treaty must have mechanisms able to provide assistance to states in need so as to ensure compliance. My delegation looks forward to engaging with other delegations in the course of our negotiations on these issues. I thank you.
I thank the distinguished representative of the Philippines. Now I give the floor to the representative of Austria.
Mr. President, in terms of institutional arrangements and other provisions, Austria would like to address the following main issues. As we said earlier, our vision for our negotiations is a lean treaty, focusing on the core prohibitions of nuclear weapons. Such a treaty will be a first but critical step towards the total elimination of nuclear weapons. Additional steps will have to follow, of course. Therefore, already in the prohibition treaty, states should express their commitment to pursue these additional steps in the future. For instance, issues such as the entry into force of the CTBT, a fissile material cutoff treaty, additional measures on verification, or a schedule for elimination of nuclear weapons will definitely be necessary as a follow-up step for achieving and maintaining the overarching goal of a nuclear weapon-free world. So we would like to see a pointer to those things in the institutional arrangements. The usual legal clause that nothing in the treaty derogates from obligations taken under other treaties, like just proposed by the Philippines, seems to us to be also necessary. It also corroborates our view that this treaty fits very well into the disarmament architecture. It is even required to complement it. As to the entry into force of the Prohibition Treaty, Austria suggests to follow the model of most comparable treaties. This means setting a simple number of ratifications required for the entry into force of the treaty, perhaps something like 30, in order to facilitate the swift and effective application of new norms of international law that it will contain. And we think it is important that it is on an equal basis, so we do not discern between different kinds of states. It's of an indiscriminate nature. In accordance with the practice under comparable treaties, meetings of states parties should be foreseen, and they could also be in a certain written review conferences. These will provide opportunities to evaluate on a regular basis the status and operation of the treaty. Meetings of states parties could also be one of the elements of a mechanism for the settlement of disputes among states parties. The goal of a nuclear weapon-free world can only be achieved by maximum inclusiveness. An accession clause should reiterate that any state which does not sign the treaty before its entry into force may accede to it at any time thereafter. Logic requires that states currently possessing nuclear weapons should commit specifically to actual elimination of their nuclear weapons upon becoming party to the treaty. This could be addressed, for example, in the following manner. Every state that adheres to the instrument would submit a declaration whether or not nuclear weapons are located on territory under its jurisdiction or control. So this again would reflect our wish that this treaty would be drafted in a way that it does not discriminate between countries. And if a state declares that nuclear weapons are located on territory under its jurisdiction or control, it would have to provide relevant details, including a proposal to remove or destroy these weapons within a specified time period. These declarations and associated proposals may then be considered by a conference of states parties or review conference that would be empowered to discuss measures of national implementation. A nuclear armed state would be required to continue reporting on progress in disarmament every year until it is free of nuclear weapons. The meeting of states parties could decide further details negotiated with the acceding state parties. In order for the treaty to be effective, states parties should commit to enact legislation and to take all other measures necessary for its implementation on the national level. It is our view that the nature of the treaty under negotiation should lead us to exclude the possibility to make reservations to any of its provisions or to withdraw from it once a state has become party. If, however, the majority of states participating in this conference would prefer a withdrawal clause, it should be a serious and long procedure. As to the duration of the treaty, comparable treaties are of unlimited duration, so we would suggest to follow the same practice. As to the depository, Austria proposes to entrust the Secretary General of the United Nations with this function, as it is also the case in most other comparable treaties. And we would like to see UNODA to assist us in the holding of the meetings of states parties. More as a general comment, I would still add that since it will be a fundamentally humanitarian treaty, the issue of victim assistance has to be included. And we would deem it right also to mention the Hibakshas. We did not discuss in a deepened way how to address the environmental impact and how to remedy it. At this late stage of our work, we want just to flag that this is a relevant issue and also to have in mind the importance of the ENMO treaty in this regard. I thank you, Mr. President.
Thank the distinguished ambassador of Austria. And now give the floor to the representative of Ireland.
Thank you, Mr. President. Firstly, I'd like to make a general point and to thank the president of the conference, the members of the Bureau, and the Secretariat for the very effective and innovative manner in which our program of work has been conducted here this week. We have moved very efficiently into our substantive program of work based on the adoption of rules of procedure which clearly serve our mandate. We have also benefited from the opportunity for interactive discussions and the views of expert panelists, as well as the very active participation of civil society, just as envisaged in our resolution, which has provided for greater clarity and creativity in all of our exchanges. So we appreciate that very much. Mr. President, we have been asked in this final cluster to focus on institutional and other arrangements. I'm conscious that many delegates wish to speak under this heading this morning, so I will mention just 4 points: resourcing supports, entry into force, reservations, and withdrawal. On the first point, clearly, as many delegates have said, the treaty will require support structures to allow for the necessary meetings of states' parties and for effective implementation, evaluation, dispute resolution, etc. However, I'm very conscious of ISU resourcing-related issues in other treaties, and I'm conscious, too, of the many burdens on states. So I would be interested in hearing more from delegates on how best to resource our essential institutional supports. UNODA has been providing excellent support to this conference, and hopefully this can continue, and I'd be interested in any creative ideas on how we manage all of that. Secondly, on entry into force, I think, like many others have already said, this should be based on a reasonable and fair threshold number of states ratifying, and should, of course, not be contingent on ratification by any particular state or group of states. Again, to endorse what seems to be a very widespread view, given the nature of this treaty, states, we believe, should not be permitted to make any reservations. Semi-compliance is not an option. On the question of withdrawal, while of course we would not want to see any withdrawals, we do think it may be advisable to provide for a withdrawal provision, in which case we would suggest basing this on standard clauses on withdrawal in other similar treaties. We might also consider inclusion of a mechanism to review such withdrawal applications, clarification that the treaty would remain in force during armed conflict, as others have said, and that obligations stemming from other related instruments would remain binding even after any withdrawal from this treaty. But we're also happy to hear from other delegations their views on this particular provision. Just lastly then, Mr. President, I'd like to touch on a couple of positive obligations issues that perhaps we didn't have the opportunity to mention in earlier interventions. In terms of victims and survivors, our understanding is that the treaty should be consistent with existing law and principles relevant to victims and survivors of the use of weapons that violate IHL and human rights law. And we've all, I think, already made such commitments in the landmines and clusters context, and we would also have made commitments with regard to the rights of persons with disabilities. So this is something to build on. I think we've had very good advice on this issue from our expert panel yesterday, and also at a very good side event yesterday at lunchtime, and there have been some very helpful working papers circulated on this issue. So this is an issue we'd like to reflect on and hopefully to discuss further as to how best to ensure that the role and the rights of victims and survivors are honoured and respected in this treaty. And lastly, in this regard, consideration of a positive obligation on disarmament education and awareness, we believe, would also be worth considering and would respond to many of the issues raised on this point at the open-ended working group, and indeed as reflected also in our resolution. Thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the distinguished representative of Ireland, and now give the floor to distinguished representative of Colombia.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Regarding this instrument on institutional arrangements and other provisions, I would have to say that the cost of future verifications, the establishment of bodies or secretariats, and the monetary obligations that would arise from a future instrument could be borne by Colombia only as from the entry into force of such a treaty without there being any retroactive effect. My delegation also believes that the IAEA is the body par excellence to provide a technical cooperation and assistance to states on the peaceful use of nuclear energy. So it is therefore appropriate to draw upon the experience and good practices of the IAEA on the establishment and development of verification measures in order to avoid duplication of work. Lastly, regarding the relationship with other international agreements, it must be emphasized that
none of the provisions in any possible instrument should run counter to other international agreements on disarmament and nuclear non-proliferation. Any possible ban treaty is an additional measure to the disarmament and non-proliferation regime. May I take this opportunity to welcome this week's work, providing sharing four ideas on the good working of a future treaty. Thank you.
I thank the distinguished representative of Colombia. Now I give the floor to the representative of Vietnam.
Thank you, Mr. President. Distinguished delegates, to ensure the full and effective implementation of a legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons, leading towards their total elimination. Regarding institutional arrangements, my delegation wishes to highlight some points as follows. First, we need a non-discriminatory and internationally verifiable legal arrangement to ensure that nuclear weapons had been destroyed and that no new weapons were being produced. Second, mechanisms for verification or enforcement could learn from the model of the Chemical Weapons Convention or of existing non-proliferation and disarmament regimes like the CTBT and the International Atomic Energy Agency safeguard system. Third, a legally binding instrument could only be effective with the participation of states possessing nuclear weapons. Mr. President, we would like to assure you of our full support in this conference process, working towards the realization of a world of peace without nuclear weapons. I thank you.
I thank the distinguished representative of Vietnam. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Malaysia.
Thank you, Mr. President, for the floor. We wish to share with the conference our contributions on some of the institutional arrangements for the potentially legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons, leading towards their total elimination. We are of the view that institutional arrangements for legally binding instrument needs to ensure that state parties are able to uphold their obligations, are not overly burdensome, and ensures that the treaty is able to function effectively once it would enter into force. In this respect, we wish to address some of the elements that could go into such arrangements for the instrument and propose on how they could be reflected. First, on national implementation and reporting, the treaty text should be simple to state that all state parties should take measures to implement the provisions of the treaty. For states that are party to nuclear weapon-free zones, they would have already committed themselves to any possible prohibitions in the instrument. However, the range of such commitments vary, with some including the prohibition of nuclear weapons in their constitutions, some have legislation, and some none at all beyond a national legal norm through practice. As such, while a national implementation measure in the instrument could call on countries to establish a contact point or designate a competent national authority to allow for an exchange of information on the implementation of the treaty, it should not call for state parties to establish new internal structures. Moreover, national implementation measures should be kept simple and up to the state without detailed prescribed methods within the text of the instrument. Reporting on national implementation measures should also be kept simple, with a reference to a first report a year after a country becomes party and subsequent reports later. Secondly, on compliance and as a corollary verification, as the instrument is envisaged as generally being a prohibition treaty, compliance would not have to require detailed procedures at this stage. For the purposes of this conference and instrument, a general provision stating that all state parties agree to the provisions of the treaty would be sufficient. Thirdly, on a future review or meetings of parties, at this point in time, a conference or meeting of state parties can follow the ATT model, whereby issues of rules of procedure and agenda can be decided during a first CSP or MSP, and the language in the instrument on the agenda of the CSP or MSP being general. A REFCON process could also be considered a possibility as well, and this in turn would suggest the common practice in most treaties of one taking place every 5 years. At this stage, it is important to be mindful that until the nuclear armed states become a party, it may not be necessary for state parties to this instrument to meet so often to discuss issues which most would already be implementing. Fourthly, on signature, ratification, and accession, the language for this should use standard treaty language, though the date of when it will be opened for signature should be not too long after the conclusion of the conference and pending clarification as to whether procedurally the GA would have to consider the report of the conference or whether the instrument would still be open for signature independent of the General Assembly considering it first. Fifthly, on entry into force, the conference would have to decide on how many ratifications or accessions would be necessary for entry into force and how soon after that number is reached would the instrument come into force. While there are no specific numbers proposed yet, the threshold should not be too high, as such a starting point for numbers should be a third of expected state parties, and in this regard, considering that 113 countries voted in favour of the resolution establishing the conference, a reasonable number would be in the 35 to 40 country range. As to when, the standard 90 days after the threshold of ratification or accession being reached should be possible. Sixthly, on provisional application, while not absolutely necessary, if it were to be included, it would have to refer specifically to the articles that would be related to the main prohibitions of the treaty. Seventhly, reservations should be allowed as long as at the time of signature, ratification, acceptance, approval, or accession, unless the reservations are incompatible with the object and purpose of the instrument. Moreover, a state party may withdraw its reservation at any time by notification to this effect addressed to the depositary. And finally, on issues of depository and authentic text, this can be based on common practice of many instruments in that the UN Secretary General is the depository, while the instrument should be published in all official UN languages. My delegation would also be open to hearing and considering other contributions that would be suggested regarding institutional arrangements. As we have stated in our previous interventions, we must be realistic and pragmatic vis-a-vis the limitations we face and concurrently the opportunities we have before us with a view to concluding our negotiations during the second sessions of the conference in July. I thank you.
I thank the Distinguished Representative of Malaysia. I now give the floor to the Distinguished Representative of Indonesia.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. With respect to institutional arrangements or governance issues, allow me to convey these following elements, which we consider merit for discussion and consideration as elements to be included in the treaty. But before proceeding, I wish to convey my delegation's general view in approaching this particular section or segment. My delegation considers institutional arrangement as one of many important key components in the implementation of the future treaty. It is indeed one component that would ensure future adherence and compliance of the treaty through necessary verification. Nevertheless, Indonesia is of the view that we ought to refrain from duplicating the existing international arrangements. Hence, we consider that this conference should look into working with or complementing existing international arrangements equipped with the necessary expertise, competence, capacity, and experience which have the potential compatibility with the future treaty. It is with this general view that my delegation wishes to approach the topic under this current agenda. With regards to the elements for the institutional arrangements or governance of the future treaty, my delegation wishes to highlight the followings. On the participation of state parties, we believe there should be a meeting of state parties held biannually except for those years where review conferences are held, starting 1 year following the entry into force of the treaty to review implementation status, to make decisions and adopt conclusions. On the issue of review conference, the treaty should also conduct review conference to be held every 5 years, starting 5 years following the entry into force of the treaty. In terms of compliance, Indonesia is of the view that state parties would be obliged to put in place national laws and regulations, including imposition of penal sanction to fully and effectively implement all the provisions of the treaty, and to prevent any proscribed activity under the treaty. Reporting on national implementation measures should also be provided and subsequently updated by states' parties annually to be reported to the United Nations through the UN Secretary General. As for expenditures of the meetings under the treaty, taking into account the standing practice of other disarmament treaties, we also believe that the expenditures of the meetings under this treaty should be borne by state parties under United Nations assessment scale. Last but not least, concerning the entry into force mechanism, Indonesia is of the view that we should avoid the mechanism of entry into force resembling that of the CTBT. The entry into force of this treaty should not be dependent on number of ratification by countries. As has been the case for CTBT, this type of mechanism will potentially prevent the treaty from coming into effect. Thank you very much.
Thank you, distinguished representative of Indonesia. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Guatemala.
Gracias, señor presidente.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Regarding the institutional arrangements, we would like to see references in the treaty on the following elements. Regarding the entry into force, this must be as simple and direct as possible. For example, after ratification by at least 25 states. Given the nature of the treaty, we believe that there should be no permission for reservations to its articles. It's important that the deadline for the commencement of the negotiation of protocols and other relevant legal instruments related to the treaty be as tight as possible after its entry into force. And again, there must be provisions for international cooperation and assistance. Regarding the organization of work, we believe that it is important to include a reference to there being annual meetings of the states' parties and periodic review conferences. Such meetings and conferences should be open to states' parties, signatories and observers, as well as to international organizations and civil society. There must be an executive secretariat under the aegis of states parties. We believe, because this is a process established by means of a General Assembly resolution, that the Secretary General should be the depository of the treaty. And it's very important for there to be references to the relation with other instruments in the treaty. It must be compatible and it must strengthen existing norms and instruments. As we said previously, this treaty has an intrinsic link with the NPT treaty, the treaties establishing areas free of nuclear weapons, and the CTBT. In particular, this treaty must be seen as a complementary and strengthening in the NPT, in particular Article 6. As we said, additional measures leading to the elimination of nuclear weapons will prove necessary within its operational provisions, although these measures to negotiate the destruction of nuclear weapons in an irreversible, verifiable, and transparent fashion will be discussed in future negotiations. However, we must
state explicitly that the new treaty must be open to all states, including those possessing nuclear weapons. Here, and complying with one of the basic principles of the treaty, that prohibition precedes elimination, any state with nuclear weapons acceding to the treaty must do so with the commitment completely to destroy its arsenal as quickly as possible, with a deadline so to do it, and this must be approved by states' parties. Thank you.
I thank the distinguished representative of Guatemala. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Cuba.
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. We would like once again to express our thanks to you for conducting this conference. Our thanks go both to the chair and to the secretariat. Regarding the institutional arrangements of a legally binding instrument prohibiting nuclear weapons and leading to their total elimination, Cuba wishes to emphasize inter alia these points. The instrument must establish a mechanism which can deal with the implementation of its provisions, inter alia here, those on verification and compliance. There must be provision for a forum for consultations and cooperation amongst the member states in order to facilitate the universalization of such an instrument. We support the idea that the instrument should be subject to the ratification of a sensible number of states regarding its entry into force, and this must not be subject to the ratification by any particular state or group of states. The instrument should allow for no reservations and must be of indefinite duration. Once its entry it has entered into force, the instrument could be amended. We support the states' parties of the instrument holding regular meetings and a review conference every 5 years. We say once again that Cuba believes that none of the provisions of such an instrument should be interpreted as restricting or rendering void the obligations entered into by states pursuant to the UN Charter on Disarmament and Non-Nuclear Proliferation provisions which are already in existence. Thank you.
I thank the distinguished representative of Cuba. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of South Africa.
Thank you, Mr. President. Let me join other delegations in thanking you for the efficient and professional manner in which you've conducted this session. We're pleased that the discussions thus far have focused mainly on the mandate of Resolution 71/258, which calls on us to negotiate a legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons, leading towards their total elimination. This is a unique opportunity, an historic opportunity. We could have easily packed in as much as we wanted, or a whole load of things. But thus far, I think we've been true to the mandate of the resolution and worked in a very efficient manner, mindful of the limited time that we have. We thank, therefore, the leadership of the conference in the president of the conference, Ambassador Elaine White. It is critical, therefore, that we use the time remaining to consolidate on what I seem to be reading as a discussion where there are many convergences. Having said this, Mr. President, allow me to briefly state South Africa's view on the institutional arrangements that may be required for effective treaty implementation. Regarding entry into force, South Africa would propose a simple approach to the threshold required for the early entry into force and suggest that the UN Secretary General act as depository of the instrument of ratification and accession. My delegation suggests that meetings of state parties that would be used to review progress in treaty implementation and universalization efforts, as well as to address any compliance issues or disputes, be limited to one meeting per calendar year. In addition, a review conference on the treaty should be held every 5 years. Mr. President, we may wish to think of an implementation support unit or secretariat that will assist with implementation and the universalization of the treaty. From our perspective, depending on developments and should the need arise, the treaty could make provision for such a decision to be made by state parties at a later date. For this purpose, the treaty text can merely state that the state parties may decide to establish implementation support mechanisms. Regarding amendments, Mr. President, the treaty should make provision for state parties to consider any amendment proposal to be adopted by a two-thirds majority of state parties. The Vienna Convention on the Law on Treaties already specifies the conditions related to reservations and withdrawal, and South Africa does not see any need for dealing with these elements in the treaty. However, should these elements be included, it would be important to ensure that the process to be followed by the states is consistent with the Vienna Convention and not open to interpretation. Regarding duration, South Africa supports an unlimited duration of the treaty. It should be indefinite. In conclusion, Mr. President, you can count on my delegation's support and cooperation, and we look forward to working with you and all delegations during the intersessional period towards the conclusion of an effective, non-discriminatory, international legally binding treaty prohibiting nuclear weapons, leading to their total elimination. I thank you.
I thank the Ambassador of South Africa. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela.
Gracias, señor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Sir, the implementation of the provisions of this treaty will come into force as soon as the text is approved and the necessary signatures and ratifications are provided. The treaty will fill the existing legal vacuum in Article 6 of the NPT, in that it will render illegal and ban a broad and comprehensive series of activities pertaining to nuclear weapons. However, total and comprehensive, complete disarmament and the elimination of nuclear weapons will start only once those countries possessing nuclear weapons decide to accede to the treaty. Professor Muksanova yesterday, in her presentation, underscored the fact that there are at least three approaches that can be used to deal with disarmament, elimination, and verification within the framework of this treaty. Firstly, the state possessing nuclear weapons must eliminate them totally and be subject to the safeguards of the IAEA, and only after that would it be able to accede to the treaty. This is a South Africa Plus formula, to which Ambassador Levy from Chile referred previously. Then secondly, the state possessing nuclear weapons would be able to negotiate an accession protocol with a commitment to eliminate its arsenal of nuclear weapons by a pre-established deadline. The ambassador of Monaco, Mexico, referred to 15 years here. Thirdly, states possessing nuclear weapons could be allowed to accede to the treaty without a pre-established deadline for the elimination of their nuclear weapons. Venezuela acknowledges the practical nature of the first of these options, the South Africa Plus formula. But we wouldn't want to shut the door on the second of the options, that is, compliance with a firm commitment to eliminate weapons within a short period. The third option would prove unacceptable because like Article 6 of the NTP, it would not give rise to any sort of commitment for the immediate elimination of nuclear weapons. Sir, we are very clear about the fact that the elimination of nuclear weapons is not the immediate object of this treaty. But as indicated by Professor Mian yesterday, the treaty is a treaty which looks to the future. It anticipates the future. It anticipates the elimination of nuclear weapons. And because of this, it must concisely provide a minimum degree of clarity regarding the process to be pursued. It must then, in the section on institutional arrangements, state that disarmament and elimination commitments on the part of countries possessing nuclear weapons and decided by them must comply with the highest standards of irreversibility, transparency, and accountability. And that the door must be left open for the treaty to grow organically with additional protocols, the negotiation of a convention or some intermediate form decided upon by the states' parties. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman.
I thank the distinguished representative of the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Thailand.
Madam President, thank you for giving me the floor. My delegation would like to share our views on the topic of institutional arrangements as follows. First and foremost, allow me to highlight that the importance of such arrangements is to ensure effective implementation of a legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons leading towards their total elimination, as well as promote universalization of the instrument. With regards to the implementation of the instrument, it is worth exploring the possibility to establish cooperation with existing bodies such as the IAEA and the CTBTO to promote technical support in order to monitor and verify compliance with relevant obligations under the instrument. Given the scope and nature of this instrument, the instrument should not impose additional unnecessary obligation to non-nuclear weapon states, but place responsibility on states possessing nuclear weapons, shall they decide to join the instrument. Additionally, we are of the view that the number of ratifications required should support the early entry into force. We are also convinced that states should not be allowed to make reservations to any of the articles of this instrument. Madam President, the instrument should also provide for regular meetings of the state parties or review conferences in order to consider and take decisions with regards to the application and implementation of the instrument. There is a need to further discuss the issue of having mechanism to provide secretarial services to the above meetings and review process, as well as to assist with other administrative arrangements in relation to the instrument. In promoting the universalization of the instrument, this mechanism should also encourage the constructive engagement and participation of states that are outside the instrument. In our opinion, such mechanism should be lean, efficient, and require minimum resources. Madam President, my delegation also views that there is a merit to consider the issue of international cooperation and assistance to be included in the instrument, in particular, that concerning environmental rehabilitation, disarmament education, and awareness raising, as well as victim assistance. In closing, Madam President, we wish to reiterate that the true success of this instrument depends on its universalization and compliance. My delegation recognizes the crucial roles of participating states, international organizations, and civil society, and promotes strong partnership in mobilizing broad-based support and working towards that end. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the distinguished representative of Thailand. And now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Kazakhstan.
Mr. President, I will be very brief. In general, my delegation agrees with the facilitated procedure for the entry into force of the treaty, following the example of the Arms Trade Treaty, after its ratification by a certain number of states. Also, we believe the withdrawal from the treaty should be strictly regulated and entail relevant consequences. It is necessary to develop a mechanism of influence on those countries that would attempt to withdraw from the treaty in the future. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the distinguished representative of Kazakhstan. Then I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Bangladesh.
Thank you, Mr. President. As other delegations have highlighted, the institutional arrangements of the treaty are important for its universalization and compliance. And from that perspective, we are pleased to note a number of areas of convergence among delegations. We would definitely lend our support to a regular mechanism for meeting of the state parties and for review of the treaty at regular intervals. We have noted certain suggestions to anchor such meetings with certain existing conferences or meetings, which we would like to explore and discuss further. We, of course, see merit in having a dedicated institutional mechanism for facilitating implementation and outreach of the treaty. Here again, we have taken note of suggestions to situate such institutional mechanism within certain existing bodies or entities. We would only underscore the importance of having such a mechanism under the auspices of the United Nations. We underscore the importance of international cooperation and assistance in terms of ensuring compliance with the treaty provisions by the states parties, including for issues like national legislation and reporting. We would reiterate that the treaty should avoid creating onerous and additional responsibilities for non-nuclear weapon states that are state parties to the treaty. We would recognize the importance of having specific provisions for settlement of disputes, preferably through consultations among the parties concerned, but if so required, by referring the cases to the meeting of state parties and other international judicial mechanisms. We agree with suggestions that a specified number of state parties ratifying the treaty should allow it to enter into force. We also see value in specific provisions for amendment to the treaty, and we would not prefer having any scope for expressing reservations while ratifying or acceding to the treaty. The area where we believe member states would require further discussions is definitely the issue of possible accession by nuclear weapon states. And here, as we listen to the interactive discussions, we tend to be inclined in favor of more of a flexible accession provision for nuclear weapon states in order for them to allow a favorable consideration of their ratification or accession at opportune time. It would, however, be advisable to stipulate specific provisions for undertaking obligations or commitments by such states towards elimination and the verification of such elimination. We have particularly taken note of some of the very constructive suggestions in this regard from the delegations of Austria, Brazil, and recently Venezuela. And we believe in our meeting in July, this is an area where we would have to collectively reflect further to find a possible way forward. Thank you very much.
I thank the distinguished representative of Bangladesh. And now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Nepal.
Thank you, Mr. President. At the outset, allow me to congratulate to the president of this conference of historic significance, and with the confidence in the ability of the president as well as the bureau to steer the work of the conference to a fruitful conclusion. I assure the whole bureau of my delegation's full cooperation in discharging the vital responsibility entrusted to it. Mr. President, nuclear disarmament has been a much deliberated subject ever since the first resolution of the United Nations General Assembly in 1946 established a commission to deal with problems related to the discovery of atomic energy. It was followed by landmark treaties on non-proliferation treaty, partial test ban treaty, and comprehensive test ban treaty, among others. And moreover, the advisory opinion of the International Court of Justice in 1996 reaffirmed that a threat or use of nuclear weapons against the principles of the UN Charter is unlawful. However, it is ironical that both horizontal and vertical proliferations continue unabated even after several international conferences. The situation is further exacerbated by modernization programs of the nuclear states, which have accorded unduly important role to nuclear weapons in their security doctrines. The existence of nuclear weapons carries with it the persistent risk of accidental, mistaken, unauthorized, or intentional detonations as well. The only way of getting out of all these risks associated with nuclear weapons is their complete elimination. Notwithstanding how arduous the work is, the world community has not lost its hope of eliminating the only weapon of mass destruction which is not yet prohibited by any international norm and treaty. The optimism shown by the majority of the member states while voting in favor of the General Assembly Resolution 71/258 is a testament to our firm determination towards a world free of nuclear weapons. Mr. President, we are aware of the indiscriminate and catastrophic humanitarian and environmental consequences of a deliberate or accidental detonation of nuclear arsenals. Earlier this week, during the conference, we heard the experience of a Hibakusa, Mr. Toshiki Fujimori. We also learned about the consequential deaths and diseases and lasting environmental devastation and cultural disruption suffered by Marshallese people due to numerous nuclear tests. These and other testimonies from around the world have always reconfirmed that no state or international organization would be able to deal with the devastating chaos and havoc created by nuclear detonations in populated areas. Contrary to the socioeconomic necessity of the humanity, huge amounts of resources are spent annually in modernization of nuclear weapons. If diverted to social and humanitarian causes, these resources could help achieve many of the sustainable development goals, including eradicating poverty and hunger before the deadline and improve the quality of life of all humanity. Therefore, the onus lies on us to devise effective normative and legal framework against nuclear weapons for ensuring a peaceful present and a secure future for humanity, as well as for the sustainable existence of our planet. Mr. President, Nepal's unwavering commitment to world peace and disarmament has been rooted in the norms of world peace, which are entrenched in the Constitution as a basis of the country's foreign policy. Nepal strongly believes in the general and complete disarmament of all weapons of mass destruction, including nuclear weapons, in a time-bound manner. With its active advocacy and support for promotion of disarmament, Nepal is honored to host the United Nations Regional Center for Peace and Disarmament in Asia and the Pacific in Kathmandu. Nepal continues to believe in the importance of creating awareness and commitment to disarmament in general and nuclear disarmament in particular, including through education, training, and track to approaches to disarmament diplomacy. My country, Nepal, is located in a neighborhood which has three member states with nuclear weapons. The risk of facing severe humanitarian and environmental disasters in the region may not be hypothetical, but very real in case of a nuclear detonation, deliberate or accidental. The avalanches in the Himalayas, the landslides in the fragile hilly areas, and radiation pollution of flora and fauna, soil, and the arteries of lives and livelihoods in the form of the extensive river systems in Nepal triggered by a nuclear detonation would create havoc much worse than what we faced during the 2015 earthquake and many other disasters combined, and will affect millions of people downstream. We do not believe that nuclear weapons can be useful deterrents. Instead, they are the cause of security dilemma among the nuclear states. In addition, transboundary movements of hazardous wastes and radioactive materials could leave devastating impacts, thus posing a persistent threat to their neighboring non-nuclear states. Therefore, we emphasize that all states with or without nuclear weapons should work together, engaging in constructive dialogues and ensuring collective security through the prohibition of nuclear weapons. Nepal strongly supports a transparent and inclusive multilateral diplomatic process in line with Article 6 of the NPT for negotiating a legally binding international instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons leading towards their ultimate elimination. We believe that the new legal instrument should completely prohibit the development, testing, production, acquisition, possession, stockpiling, transfer, use, and threat of use of nuclear weapons, as well as the production of weapons-usable fissile material. The new instrument should also prohibit the member states, their nationals, and any other individuals from assisting, financing, encouraging, and inducing the acts prohibited by the treaty itself. While the new instrument should respect the inalienable right of all states to research, produce, and use nuclear energy for peaceful purposes without discrimination and in conformity with their relevant international obligations, it should also ensure that the rights of victims and survivors of nuclear activities are protected. It should also promote international cooperation and provide technical assistance to non-nuclear states, particularly the least developed countries, for fulfilling their obligations in implementing the treaty. Mr. President, a transparent, precise, unambiguous, non-discriminatory, and legally sound instrument with ambitious but achievable prohibition goals will be a critical contribution towards disarmament and sustainable world peace. Therefore, the provisions for irreversible, verifiable, and transparent destruction of existing nuclear weapons should be formally incorporated in the new instrument. It should be compatible with the provisions of NPT, CTBT, and IAEA, and should also reinforce them. It should clearly pronounce that the use of nuclear weapons is against the principles of the UN Charter and is therefore irreconcilable with international humanitarian and human rights laws. Moreover, the instrument should have the provisions of legally binding verification mechanisms, including routine and challenge inspections, as well as measures for the use of on-site sensors, satellite photography, radionuclide sampling, and other remote sensors. It should also establish an international monitoring system and an agency for ensuring compliance. The new instrument should recognize the indispensable role of the parliamentarians, academicians, women, youth, civil society, and other stakeholders for its successful implementation, which will ultimately contribute towards total elimination of the nuclear weapons. The treaty should also have a mechanism for working in partnership with these non-state actors to raise the awareness of the people about the devastating intragenerational and intergenerational consequences. Mr. President, before I conclude, let me reiterate the conviction of Nepal that the possession, use, and threat of use of nuclear weapons are an inhuman act requiring constructive engagement of all states and non-state stakeholders for the elimination of nuclear weapons. Indeed, the conspicuous absence of some member states of the UN in this conference has shaken our hope by posing a serious question. Are we negotiating a treaty to disarm the unarmed states? However, we must never lose hope that they will realize their greater responsibility towards humanity and will come back to the negotiation table sooner than later for the sake of a secure and prosperous future for their own peoples as well as for the sake of the humanity as a whole. Since the new treaty cannot be implemented successfully without the cooperative and consensual participation of the states possessing nuclear weapons, we should redouble our diplomatic efforts to create an environment of mutual trust and confidence. We should also re-energize our collective political will to achieve shared objectives of global peace, security, and prosperity by eliminating nuclear weapons and diverting resources used for armaments towards achieving sustainable development goals and beyond. Nepal will continue to work closely ahead with you, with the Bureau, and all delegations seeking a successful conference, which will be the success of the entire humanity. I thank you, Ms. President.
I thank the distinguished permanent representative of Nepal. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Libya.
Thank you, Mr. President. My country's delegation should like to briefly make the following points. First, the instrument which we seek to draw up needs to reinforce all other instruments pertaining to disarmament in general. This includes the CTBT, this includes the NPT, as well as all other treaties having to do with nuclear weapons-free zones. This is also an instrument which must go hand in hand with Article 6 of the NPT. Furthermore, this instrument must explicitly stipulate transparent and irreversible destruction of nuclear weapons arsenals. This destruction must be verifiable. We need to set up a specific timetable. Third, as regards the entry into force of this instrument, it would be constructive, as was mentioned by a number of colleagues, it would be wise for this mechanism to enter into force with a specific threshold, the existence of a specific number of states. Once we have a specific number of states, our aim is to move forward. Fourth, we believe that this instrument must stipulate regular meetings and conferences for states parties and for the purposes of review of this instrument. I'd like lastly to thank you, sir, for the efforts undertaken this week. We greatly appreciate the political will demonstrated by a number of states who have participated here. Of course, we cannot refer to all civil society organizations and all other stakeholders present with us, but we are eager to cooperate with all stakeholders, including during our meeting in July. Thank you.
Thank the distinguished representative of Libya. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Liechtenstein.
Thank you, Mr. President. Mr. President, with the discussion of this last topic today, we conclude a very productive week with broad engagement and very interesting exchanges. This is a solid basis to collectively move ahead in our common project and agree on a nuclear weapons ban treaty. Mr. President, on the topic at hand, the institutional arrangements, let me reiterate that a nuclear ban treaty is a crucial contribution to the implementation of the NPT's Article 6 obligation to pursue nuclear disarmament negotiations in good faith. Appropriate institutional arrangements are needed to support the states' parties in implementing the treaty and advancing its universalization. These arrangements should take into account that in the future, additional measures, both practical and normative, might be needed to advance nuclear disarmament. In general, the treaty's arrangements could be modeled after the institutional arrangement of other successful treaties in the area. Liechtenstein supports creating institutional arrangements to support states' parties in treaty implementation. We are open to considering different options which give due regard to efficiency, including on resources, and by using existing expertise in the treaty's substance matter. This should include a clear mandate to oversee implementation and ensure compliance with the treaty's provision. We support those who call for building on existing expertise and institutional arrangements in the field of verification once this becomes necessary, including with the IAEA and the CTBT. We should also envisage mandating regular meetings of state parties and foresee the option of review conferences in order to allow states to engage on reviewing implementation, possibly also verification, on achieving universality, and also on questions of amendments or additions to the treaty. The treaty should include provisions on international cooperation and assistance that suggest areas where implementation assistance might be focused and discuss technical assistance to help states meeting treaty's obligation. For dispute settlement, the treaty should establish a procedure in line with other comparable treaties. In order to account for future developments, the treaty could foresee the possibility of amendments. The relevant provisions should not be too cumbersome or complicated. Furthermore, the ban treaty should not preclude other measures and further instruments to be developed at a later stage related to disarmament. Given the nature of the treaty, states' parties should not be allowed to place reservations on the treaty. On joining the treaty, based on precedents, the treaty should be open for signature to all states and subject to ratification, with a later possibility for states to accede. The treaty should urge state parties to actively work on universalization of the treaty. Through the creation of a stigma on nuclear weapons, the process of banning them should require governments to reject nuclear weapons for good and in their entirety. The entry into force should take effect after a determined number of states has ratified the treaty with no further conditions attached. The ATT could provide guidance in determining that number. I thank you.
Thank the distinguished representative of Liechtenstein. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Trinidad and Tobago. Do we have Trinidad and Tobago in the room?
President,
we have the floor.
Trinidad and Tobago associates with the statement delivered by Antigua and Barbuda on behalf of the member states of the Caribbean community. Mr. President, as we turn our attention to topic three, institutional arrangements, my delegation reiterates the following essential elements which should continue to underpin our negotiations in this aspect of the treaty. The humanitarian concerns of nuclear weapons, one, Two, the ability of the treaty to build upon and reinforce the existing legal framework regarding the prohibition of inhumane and indiscriminate weapons, such as the Biological Weapons Convention, the Chemical Weapons Convention, the Anti-Personnel Landmines Treaty, and the Convention on Cluster Munitions. Three, the extent to which the treaty reinforces other instruments that regulate nuclear weapons, such as the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty, the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, and Nuclear Weapon Free Zone Treaties. The treaty must be conceived as an important part of the mandate of the NPT to pursue multilateral nuclear disarmament in good faith set out in its Article 6. Against this backdrop, Mr. President, my delegation submits that the treaty's institutional arrangements should contain recognition of the rights of victims, including women, children, and the disabled, their challenges and need for assistance within a broader human rights-based framework. Additionally, the treaty must include additional practical and legally binding measures that will ensure the destruction of existing nuclear weapons in an irreversible, verifiable, and transparent manner. Efforts aimed at universalization of the treaty is imperative. In this respect, it is necessary to require states' parties to implement national, legal, administrative, and regulatory measures to prevent and suppress any activity prohibited to a state under the treaty. With respect to the treaty, with respect to the entry into force, we support a simple provision that the treaty will require a reasonable number of states to ratify it for it to become binding international law. We are open to discussion regarding the specific details of this point. Moreover, entry into force must depend on the ratification of any state or group of states, and as it is the case with other weapons-related instruments, no state should be allowed to make reservations to any of the articles of this treaty. Mr. President, my delegation reiterates that the treaty should provide for international cooperation and assistance to meet the obligations of the instrument, and we support an institutional mechanism that would facilitate the treaty's implementation and universalization. The institutional mechanism could be the repository of the treaty and a centralized structure to manage the operation of the treaty. This mechanism will also be charged with inter alia, organizing review conferences of state parties promoting the implementation and universalization of the treaty. We also envisage a role for the IAEA. Finally, Mr. President, perhaps we could consider civil society as the guardians or watchkeepers of this potential treaty, as they have played an invaluable role in advocating for this process. My delegation, therefore, supports the inclusion of civil society in this treaty as instrumental in applying and implementing the treaty, as well as in raising awareness regarding the humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapon. Mr. President, I thank you.
We thank the distinguished permanent representative of Trinidad and Tobago. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Fiji.
Thank you, Mr. President. First of all, we wish to congratulate you as president of the conference and commend you for the excellent stewardship of this week's proceedings. We are taking the floor for the first time at this session. Firstly, allow me to share our views on the earlier topics addressed this week before coming to the issues of institutional arrangements. In this regard, Mr. President, the topic on principal objectives. Fiji once again stressed the objective to negotiate a legally binding instrument is to prohibit any use or threat of nuclear weapons based on international humanitarian law and human rights. Fiji speaks with first-hand experience of the destruction and long-lasting effects that nuclear weapons have had on our people, without victim assistance, reparation, and environmental degradation of the ecosystem. As a Pacific Island state, the region has faced the environmental and human consequences of more than 300 forced nuclear tests conducted over half a century. Even until today, it still remains unsafe for habitation, agricultural production, and fishing, which was drastically and permanently displaced islanders from their homes and disconnected the indigenous way of life for many Fijians of untold pain. The drive of this treaty has been based around the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons, especially the case for the population of Pacific Island nations in regard to nuclear weapons testing, which led to the suffering of our people's health, our environments, and displacement of people. Fiji endorses, firstly, the recognition of the rights of victims of the use and testing of nuclear weapons and a commitment to provide assistance to victims and environmental redress for Pacific Islanders who have lost much as a result of nuclear testing. Secondly, the issue of visitation, transit, overflight, stationing, and deployment. The Pacific Ocean's geographical position and composition makes the region particularly susceptible to these abuses. The Pacific region is not a nuclear weapons trial zone, neither it is not a laboratory for nuclear development and proliferation, and it surely must not be used as a launching pad for nuclear attacks. Therefore, Fiji supports the strengthening of nuclear weapon-free zone transparency measures for the establishment of a reporting mechanism that works within the framework of the UN as a positive step to enhance accountability, promote transparency, and in turn, facilitate nuclear disarmament and legally binding treaty banning nuclear weapons that would fill the gap, legal gap to end violence and promote harmony in the world to achieve justice and respect for human rights. Nuclear weapons have immediate, mid-term and long-term effects across many generations, disproportionately affecting women and female children. We need to ban nuclear weapons to reduce the risk of accidental, mistaken, unauthorized or intentional use of nuclear weapons. So the treaty should emphasize the need to establish a clear legal standard to prohibit nuclear weapons, to reject any role for nuclear weapons in security doctrines or arrangements, and must recognize the goal of complete disarmament. All states are responsible to maintain international peace, security, and justice. On the topic of co-prohibition and legal measures, Fiji asks for a legal binding international instrument to explicitly prohibit nuclear weapons, which will stigmatize their possession and facilitate nuclear disarmament by prohibiting activities such as development, production, testing, acquisition, stockpiling, transfer, deployment, and use of threat of nuclear weapons, and also prohibit assisting, financing, encouraging, and inducing prohibit acts. The treaty should provide an obligation for a complete elimination of nuclear weapons and a framework to achieve it that would build on and reinforce other legal instruments and should reaffirm the rights of people who have suffered from nuclear weapons in relation to rights of redress, especially to compensation from harm as a result of the use of nuclear weapons. There should be positive obligations to ensure rights of victims and survivors, to address the affected environments and provide international cooperation and assistance to meet obligations. Coming then to institutional arrangements, our view is that the treaty should be compatible with, build upon, and strengthen other key instruments, including the Non-Proliferation Treaty, Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, and Nuclear Weapons Free Zone Treaties. Fiji does not possess nuclear weapons. Fiji is a signatory to the South Pacific Nuclear Weapon Free Zone Treaty, known also as the Treaty of Rarotonga. The Treaty of Rarotonga has established the South Pacific as an internationally recognized nuclear weapon-free zone. Nuclear weapon-free zones have been essential tools for establishing strong regional norms against the use, testing, and possession of nuclear weapons for a new legally binding instrument that would transform regional norms into global norms. Some specific elements that Fiji consider important for the treaty include the following, Mr. President. One, the treaty should include a simple entry into force provision stipulating that it will become binding in international law once a member state have ratified it. Entry into force must not be contingent upon the ratification of any particular state or group of states. Two, states should not be allowed to make reservations to any of the articles of this treaty. Consistent to other weapons-related international arrangements, agreements such as prohibitions of biological and chemical weapons, landmines and cluster munitions, as well as nuclear weapon-free zone. Three, the treaty should provide for international cooperation and assistance to meet obligations of the instrument. Four, There should be regular meeting of states to and review conferences in order to consider and take decisions with regard to the application or implementation of the treaty, such as concerning the cooperation and status of the treaty, matters arising from reports submitted to the treaty, international cooperation and assistance regarding the treaty, stockpile destruction, and related verification measures and other issues. Fifth, civil societies, relevant organizations and institutions should be allowed to participate in these meetings as observers. Finding a text of the treaty should be made ready as soon as possible to allow states to negotiate in terms. I thank you again, Mr. President, for giving me the floor.
I thank the distinguished representative of Fiji. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Timor-Leste.
Thank you, Mr. President, for giving us the floor. We have listened very carefully to the discussion, and Timor-Leste shares the views of ASEAN member countries as presented in the statement by the distinguished representative of the Philippines. In general comments, Mr. President, Timor-Leste views that a legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons negotiated in this conference shall reflect the following points. First, humanitarian consequences. Nuclear weapon explosions and testing have caused unacceptable harm to generations of people. It demonstrated devastating immediate, mid-term, and long-term effects. Moreover, the impact of nuclear weapon detonation cannot be contained by national borders and therefore could have regional and even global consequences, destruction, death, displacement, as well as a long-term damage to the environment. Second, risk. The continued existence of nuclear weapons is a high risk for the existence of humanity. The risk of unauthorized or intentional use of nuclear weapons due to the vulnerability of nuclear command and control may contribute to the instability at the regional and at the global level. Third, international law. It is imperative to put into consideration all rules of international humanitarian law, such as the rule prohibiting attacks directed at civilians or civilian objects, the rule of prohibiting indiscriminate attacks, and the rule on the protection of the natural environment. Timor-Leste also views that it is also imperative that the treaty should prohibit its parties, the nationals, and any other individuals subject to its jurisdiction from engaging in activities such as development, production, testing, acquisition, stockpiling, transfer, deployment, and use and threat of use of nuclear weapons. The treaty should also prohibit its parties, their nationals, and any other individuals subject to its jurisdiction from assisting, financing, encouraging, and inducing acts under prohibition. Finally, the treaty should also include positive obligations for state parties, such as ensuring the rights of victims and survivors of nuclear weapons activities, requiring actions to address damage to affected environments, and providing for international cooperation and assistance to meet the obligations of the instrument. Mr. President, in conclusion, Timor-Leste recognizes the efforts made by the United Nations in securing regional and global stability. However, the realization of a world that is free from nuclear weapons requires political will, collective efforts of all, as well as putting the values of humanity on top of other concerns. In these collective efforts, Timor-Leste continues to count on efforts made by civil societies, academia, and international community. I thank you, Mr. President.
Thank the distinguished representative of Timor-Leste. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of New Zealand.
Mr. President, New Zealand is pleased to join in the discussion here today on topic 3, institutional arrangements and other provisions, and I would like to take the opportunity to comment in particular on the depository, the arrangements to be specified for institutional support, requirements regarding entry into force and the provisions we might have regarding reservations and withdrawal. First, as regards the depository, in the view of my delegation, the most obvious candidate to act as depository for our treaty would be the Secretary General of the UN, who could fulfill this function on the same basis as he does with respect to so many other treaties. With regard to institutional support, perhaps the most obvious source for some measure of support for the implementation of our treaty would equally be the Secretary General, which is to say the ODA. In suggesting this, Mr. President, I am aware that all of us here have had considerable experience in recent years with the range of options available to give institutional support to the implementation of treaty regimes. There is a spectrum from, at one extreme, the example of the NPT, which has never had any mechanism for institutional support, to examples at the other end of the spectrum of standalone implementation support units, e.g. for landmines and cluster munitions, or standalone secretariats, e.g. the Arms Trade Treaty. With the funding issues that can arise in connection with standalone support units uppermost in our minds, perhaps we could look at something in the way of a halfway house between the two alternatives I have just referred to. Perhaps then our nuclear prohibition treaty could be supported by the UN Office of Disarmament Affairs. And we believe this would be a cost-efficient way of providing institutional support for the regime and inter alia, for supporting the holding of annual meetings of states' parties and managing the mechanisms that will need to be established for dispute settlement. With regard to provisions for the entry into force of the treaty, I think, Mr. President, that for everyone here, the CTBT continues to provide a salutary example of an entry into force threshold which was set so high that the aims and objectives of the treaty's drafters, and indeed of almost the entire international community, remain frustrated in the face of its ongoing non-entry into force. We must therefore ensure that the threshold set for the entry into force of our prohibition treaty is that of a sensible, neither too high nor too low, numerical limit, as was done with respect, for instance, to the Arms Trade Treaty. We also believe that the treaty should be of indefinite duration. As to reservations, whilst acknowledging that the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties provides in general a sensible regime with respect to the ability to enter reservations, New Zealand finds it a little difficult to envisage any reservation that might in fact be made to the Prohibition Treaty that was not likely to be contrary to its object and purpose. This would certainly be the case with regard to any reservation made in respect of any of its prohibitions. And in such circumstances, New Zealand favours the treaty, making it clear that reservations are not permitted. The final issue my delegation would like to comment upon is that of withdrawal. On this issue, Mr. President, we find ourselves rather conflicted. A priori, we believe a treaty setting a global norm to prohibit nuclear weapons should desirably not seem to contemplate the prospect of any withdrawal from it. We have, however, heard comments from a number of delegations over recent days who have suggested that the absence of a right to withdraw from the treaty could prove a barrier to joining it in the first place. We are conscious, too, of the provision in the NPT, and for that matter also the CTBT, regarding the qualified right of states to withdraw from those treaties, and we acknowledge the precedential importance of them. We will continue to listen with interest to the views of all colleagues on this issue. Whilst on the views of colleagues, Mr. President, May I take this opportunity to thank all the panelists we heard from yesterday. My delegation found their insights of great value, and I would certainly hope that we will be able to draw again on their expertise during our concluding session this coming June, July. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thanks, the Ambassador of New Zealand. And now give the floor to the distinguished representative of Solomon Islands.
On entry into force, my delegation feels that the treaty should include just a simple entry into force provision, stating that it will also become binding international law once a certain number of states have ratified it. And like other delegations, the entry into force must not be contingent upon the ratification of any particular state or group of states. On reservations, like most other weapons-related international agreements, states should not be allowed to make reservations to any of the articles of this treaty. Implementation of the treaty, states' parties should commit to encourage all states, not parties, to join the treaty so that we can give it some universality. The treaty should establish procedure for state parties to clarify and seek to resolve questions related to compliance with the treaty by other state parties, and notification by a state of its intention to withdraw should, in my delegation's view, immediately trigger a meeting of state parties. The treaty should also encourage states to educate their citizens, create awareness among their citizens and, of course, the militaries about the catastrophic humanitarian consequences of nuclear weapons, their associated risks, and the norms embedded in the treaty. And it should provide for regular meetings of states' parties and review conferences in order to consider and take decisions with regard to the application or implementation of the treaty. This treaty is an important contribution towards nuclear disarmament. Therefore, additional measures, both practical and legally binding, for the irreversible, verifiable, and transparent destruction of nuclear weapons will also be needed in order to achieve and maintain a world without nuclear weapons. Relationship with other treaties, it should reinforce other instruments prohibiting inhumane and indiscriminate weapons, such as the Biological Weapons Convention, Chemical Weapons Convention, and Anti-Personnel Landmines Treaty, and the Convention on Cluster Munitions. There should also be a secretariat to oversee the implementation of the treaty, provide a forum for consultation and cooperation among state parties, organize meetings of state parties and other agreed roles. And here I heard New Zealand and other delegations on their views on this one, but that's something, of course, we can further consult on. And state not parties to the treaty, as well as the United Nations, other relevant international organizations, institutions, and civil society should be allowed to participate in these meetings as observers. Mr. President, as eloquently put by my colleague from Fiji earlier on this morning, the Pacific Islands have been disproportionately affected by the 300 nuclear weapons test detonations during the 1940s to as late as 1960. And in regard to the importance of our marine environments too, there's been a lot of destruction. As a result, Solomon Islands calls for the treaty's institutional arrangement to ensure all states' parties provide for international cooperation and assistance to help affected state parties meet their positive obligations And these positive obligations include environmental rehabilitation, risk awareness, assistance to victims and survivors, and stockpile destruction, but with no onerous obligation on non-nuclear states. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the distinguished permanent representative of Solomon Islands. And now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Egypt.
Thank you, Mr. President. My delegation believes that the following possible institutional arrangements could be incorporated in a legally binding instrument for the prohibition of nuclear weapons leading towards their total elimination. A new instrument could hold an annual conference of state parties that assumes the responsibility to achieve the objective and purpose of the treaty, to ensure the implementation of its provisions, including those for verification, achieve its universality, and to provide a forum for consultation and cooperation among state parties. It should educate the public about the contents of the treaty and the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. A new instrument could include a periodic review mechanism that would review and strengthen the implementation of the new instrument and review its operation and status. Such a review conference could be held similar to practices conducted in other conventions every 5 years. A review conference should be convened by the Secretary General of the United Nations 5 years after the entry into force of the new instrument. The treaty should be open for signature by any state and should be subject to ratification by its signatories. With regards to the issue of entry into force, the instrument should enter into force after a specified number of states have ratified it. It should not be conditional upon the ratification of any particular state or group of states. The instrument should include provisions that allow for the sovereign right of withdrawal of any state from the treaty in accordance with the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties. We believe, Mr. President, that an institutional structure ought to be established within the framework of the instrument in order to enable it to conduct all necessary coordinating matters related to verification as well as technical assistance in collaboration in order to collaborate with the International Atomic Energy Agency. I thank you, Mr. President.
I thank the distinguished representative of Egypt. Now I give the floor to the distinguished representative of Islamic Republic of Iran.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Our discussion under institutional arrangements have to cover two sets of issues. First, issues related to the establishment of relevant organization of the future instrument, conference or meeting of state parties, and review conferences of the parties thereto. Second, issues that are known as the final clauses of the legally binding instruments that include such issues as signing, ratification, enter into force, dispute settlement, reservation, withdrawal, amendment, depository, relationship of the instrument with other relevant legally binding instruments, relationship of its states parties with non-parties, the authentic text of the instrument, and finally, how to improve and ensure its universalization. At the same time, it is quite evident that the final shape of some, if not many, of such issues are directly dependent on the scope and objectives of the future instrument and its verification mechanism. In light of its positions and preferences with respect to the scope of prohibitions, verification mechanism, and provisions on elimination of nuclear weapons, my delegation would like to make some preliminary comments and observations on the institutional related issues as follows. Taking into account that the CWC is the most comprehensive and effective international legally binding instrument, banning a specific category of weapons of mass destruction, it would be appropriate and prudent to draw on the institutional arrangements, to draw on its institutional arrangements. For instance, through the instrument being under consideration, we can establish an organization for the prohibition of nuclear weapons, OPNW. The mandate and construction of the OPCW can apply to the OPNW mutatis mutandis. In this context, we heard several delegations suggesting that the IAEA can play the role of main organization for the future instrument. We shared the views that the provisions of the IAEA stated provides for the verification of nuclear disarmament arrangements. We also take into account the fact that almost all the participating states in this conference are the IAEA member states. However, we have serious doubts that the IAEA can play such a role, due mainly to the fact that the IAEA operates under the authority and based on the decision of its board of governors, the membership of which always include over 50 countries that are absent in this conference and are not expected to participate to the future instrument, at least in the short run. Therefore, it is quite impossible to allow such a body composed of many non-parties to this instrument to take decisions concerning its implementation or verification of compliance with obligations thereunder. This important issue needs to be taken into account while considering the institutional arrangements. On COP, MOP, review conference, and the like, my delegation believes that we can also use the same model of COP, MOP, review conference, and the Executive Council of the CWC. We also believe that in most cases, we can also use almost the same formula of the CWC final clauses, namely on signing, ratification, entry into force, dispute settlement, reservation, withdrawal, amendment, depository, and relationship of instrument with other relevant legally binding documents, as well as the relationship of its states' parties with non-parties. I would like to stress once again that the future instrument should complement all existing international legally binding instruments governing nuclear weapons. Moreover, in terms of elimination, its implementation needs to be time-bound and should not be left to an unpredictable future. Finally, in our view, the issues related to implementation of the future instruments are of utmost importance and therefore deserve our particular attention. In this connection, and taking into account the experience we had previous days, actually yesterday in having a useful exchange of views, we have to consider all technical aspects of the implementation of the instrument, and to do so, we need technical information. That is why we believe it would be appropriate and a good idea to invite the representatives of certain international organizations to participate in the conference in its June-July session to shed a light on such complicated technical aspects. This indeed would enable us to have a comprehensive picture of such important issues and at the same time accurate and complete information on those subjects. Accordingly, we can consider inviting the representatives of OPCW, IAEA, CTBTO, PREPCOM, BWC, ISU, and 15 for the committee for issues related to disarmament and non-proliferation aspects of the implementation of the future instrument. Likewise, we can consider inviting the representatives of international financial and monetary institutions, such as the World Bank, for briefing the conference on mechanisms and requirements of implementing the provisions of the instrument on prohibition of investment and financing. Equally, Mr. President, we may consider inviting the representatives of World Customs Organization, WCO, International Maritime Organization, IMO, International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO, and International Road Transportation Union, IRU, for educating the conference on the issues related to the implementation of provisions of the instrument on such prohibitions as import, export, transit, transfer, and transshipment. Finally, we also see merits in inviting the representatives of the institutions related to some nuclear weapon-free zones, in particular from Africa and the Latin America. I thank you, Mr. President.
I think with the distinguished representative of Islamic Republic of Iran, I now give the floor to the distinguished representative of Ecuador.
Muchas gracias, señor presidente.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. The delegation of Ecuador would like to refer to the institutional arrangements and other aspects pertaining to the future treaty. We believe that we should consider the inclusion of assistance to the victims of nuclear explosions and environmental redress of the damage caused by these explosions, whether to be no clauses of this nature in an instrument which arises because of a serious humanitarian concern about the consequences of the use of nuclear weapons would be contradictory. When these clauses are considered, due account must be attributed to the responsibility of states responsible for the explosions without, however, overlooking the primary responsibility of those states whose citizens would be affected by such explosions. So here, it will be important for there to be further discussion between states and experts from civil society on a possible implementation mechanism for this positive obligation. We believe that the treaty should be open to the signatory of all, to the signature of all states, and that the entry into force of the instrument should come about on the basis of a reasonable number of ratifications, endowing it with the necessary legitimacy, but the number should not be so high that it would unnecessarily affect its entry into force. In no way could there be a requirement of a ratification of a certain group of states to allow the entry into force. I believe that we should never repeat the error of Annex 2 of the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty. The duration of the treaty should be indefinite, and no reservations should be allowed regarding any of its provisions. It would be possible to consider withdrawing from the treaty pursuant to Article 56 of the Vienna Convention on Treaty Law. However, we would say that it's not absolutely necessary to have such clauses for rescinding the treaty. However, should the conference decide to have this instrument, certain conditions and requirements should be necessary, should be included, and this will require further dialogue against all participants. Then another area which we think could prove extremely complex is what
should be done were there to be a non-compliance with the treaty. We think that in any case, these hypothetical situations of non-compliance should not be given to bodies outside the treaty to consider. It would be more appropriate to consider the creation of a mechanism within the instrument, for example, the convening of an emergency meeting by the state's parties. Regarding verification, we would believe there's a question that needs further to be explored. That is, what should be verified in the treaty? Compliance with nuclear disarmament or a compliance regarding the prohibitions in the treaty? We think that once we all enjoy greater clarity on this, it might well be easier to consider the provisions on this particular issue. The treaty should stipulate that there should be annual meetings and emergency meetings of the Conference of States Parties, indicating the reasons and also scheduling of such emergency meetings. The Conference of States Parties should be able to negotiate and adopt protocols allowing the treaty to grow organically, as well as the inclusion of implementation mechanisms for its provisions. We believe, again, that there should be review conferences, if possible, every 5 years. These would have the task of scrutinizing the implementation and universalization of the treaty. On the conferences of states parties and review conferences, there should be invitations extended to observer states which are not under the nuclear weapons-free area, also the UN and its agencies, the IAEA, the NTP, the International Red Cross, and the Committee of the International Red Cross and Red Crescent. There should also be provision for participation on the part of civil society. However, were there to be hypothetical failures to comply with the treaty, and given the formula to be put forward for this, obviously these states parties meetings under such circumstances would be open only to states parties without there being any observers present. We believe that we could consider establishing an executive secretariat with a clearly defined restricted role regarding the relation, the mechanisms for technical assistance and communications pertaining to the implementation of the treaty. However, again, we think further discussion is needed on this. And in any case, a subsequent decision of the Conference of States Parties that could always be taken on this in an additional protocol were that to be deemed necessary. And lastly, there should be provisions in the treaty on international cooperation and technical assistance, both regarding compliance with the prohibitions and the positive obligations enshrined in the treaty. Thank you very much.
I thank the distinguished representative of Ecuador. Now we give the floor to the distinguished representative of Switzerland.
Thank you for the opportunity to have an exchange on the legal and institutional aspects of the treaty. To some extent, the topic at hand constitutes a challenge at this early stage, when so many aspects of the treaty are yet to be developed. A better understanding of the requirements will be essential before we can sketch out the necessary support structures of this treaty. For instance, only when we know what type of verification, what kind of compliance mechanism, what kind of reporting, or what transparency measures result from the agreement, we can be more specific about institutional arrangements. Or simply put, we should stick to the principle that form follows function. Having said this, my delegation is, however, ready to share some of our initial views. As a matter of principle, we think it would be wise to keep the treaty's institutional footprint as limited as practically possible. This would correspond to the shared view that the ban is one instrument among several, and that it is underlying function and that its underlying function is to contribute to effective implementation of Article 6 of the NPT, which remains the cornerstone of nuclear non-proliferation and disarmament regime. Meetings or conferences of states parties would seem to be necessary. Only a few treaties entail no regular meetings. The practice today is to put in place structures that facilitate the implementation of the norms negotiated. However, we will have to look at the actual need in terms of length and periodicity. In this context, we would like to re-emphasize the treaty's complementary nature to the NPT. The Ban Treaty is but one piece of puzzle in the existing architecture, leading to a world free of nuclear weapons. This should also be reflected in the meeting structure. Also, we should as much as possible rely on existing structures and not create specific new ones in support of this treaty. The fact that verification guarantees should be outsourced to the IAEA has already been highlighted on numerous occasions. The servicing of any meeting or conference of states parties should be provided by the UN. The UN could also do any other basic secretarial support if and when required. In case the treaty will entail a reporting system, and we do believe that the treaty should have requirements of this nature, a possible way forward would be to build on the repository of information provided by nuclear weapon states, which was established on the UNADA's website based on Action 21 of the final document of the 2010 NPT Review Conference. Another area where we will need to have greater clarity before being able to move forward on institutional aspects is whether the treaty will be open to additional protocols for states possessing nuclear weapons, even though we remain to be convinced about the concrete added value of this option. Somewhat related to that issue are the provisions for amendments to the treaty. Careful consideration will have to be given to this issue, and several options can be considered in this area. Regarding the duration of the treaty, we do not see any reason why it should be limited in time. It should be of indefinite duration, in line with the shared understanding that the treaty should fill a legal gap, which of course should be filled permanently. When it comes to the issue of withdrawal from the treaty, we are of the view that this should be possible. However, we think any withdrawal should be linked to very specific requirements. There is a standard approach that we find in many disarmament treaties like the NPT, the CTBT, the zone treaties, as well as the CWC, where withdrawal is possible if extraordinary events linked to the subject of the treaty arise. Such a formula seems appropriate for our treaty as well. We would specify that in view of the possible consequences of any withdrawal from the Treaty for International Peace and Security, the withdrawal should be notified to the UN Security Council and also trigger an extraordinary meeting of state parties. The withdrawal provision should also recall that the withdrawal shall not in any way affect the obligation of states to continue to comply with relevant rules of international law, notably the Charter of the UN, IHL, and human rights laws. Regarding the entry into force, provisions should remain straightforward, not establishing a complicated and certainly not a discriminatory formula. Entry into force should simply follow ratification by a set number of states. In view of the nature of the treaty, there is no need for that number to be unduly high. Finally, regarding the question of the appropriate depository, there is no reason for not granting this task to the Secretary General of the United Nations. Thank you, Mr. President.
I think the distinguished representative of Switzerland, we give the floor now to the representative of Uganda.
Mr. President, I seize the opportunity to register my delegation's appreciation to you for your leadership in presiding over this conference, which is a great stride towards ending the two decades deadlock of lack of progress in multilateral nuclear disarmament negotiations. A prohibition treaty based on humanitarian principle is a critical step towards a world free of nuclear weapons. Let me thank also the distinguished delegates, academia, civil society, experts, and the media for their active participation in the conference. Nuclear weapon states and the member states participating in this conference need to cooperate as we work towards prohibiting the development and the use of nuclear weapons. It's therefore our desire and request that all states participate in these negotiations, because the world belongs to all of us, and we have a duty to both the current and future generation. Therefore, these negotiations provide an opportunity to elaborate concrete, effective legal measures, legal provisions, norms that will lead to the prohibition of nuclear weapons. Uganda acknowledges the NPT pillar on the right to peaceful use of nuclear energy. In that regard, my delegation takes note of the need to have a clear definition of nuclear weapons in the prohibition treaty. Ambiguity of the definitions may create gaps which might impact the right to peaceful uses of nuclear technology. Nevertheless, I'm confident that with your able leadership, Mr. President, this issue will be given due consideration. Mr. President, my delegation would now like to submit some specific suggestions to be included in the institutional arrangements for the legally binding instrument to prohibit nuclear weapons. Effective implementation of the treaty will require establishment of institutions that will ensure compliance, monitoring, verification, and of course, enforcement of non-compliance. My delegation proposes a dedicated agency be established under the auspices of the United Nations. The agency should have a secretariat and an executive board of state parties, or otherwise known as board of governors. The membership of this board can be decided in the meeting of state parties. Mr. President, my delegation further proposes that the secretariat should be mandated to conduct research, provide public knowledge about the treaty and the humanitarian impact of nuclear weapons. Two, facilitate the accession to the treaty by state parties or states. Three, provide a forum for consultation and cooperation among state parties. This forum could be done through regular meetings of the state parties to the treaty. This method of peer review can provide good means of monitoring compliance to the treaty. Mr. President, my delegation suggests that the Board of Governors is mandated to take key decisions on major issues such as compliance and agreements with nuclear weapon states who would like to join the treaty. In the case of the need for verification for non-compliance, the board would then directly request for the technical assistance of the International Atomic Energy Agency, the IAEA. The verification will then be done based on the well-developed IAEA safeguards protocol. This can be done on case-by-case basis. Mr. President, in case of non-compliance and failed negotiations at the level of Board of Governors, the matter may be referred to the International Court of Justice for decision, which can further be discussed at the UN General Assembly. Finally, Mr. President, let me re-echo the shared concern by most delegations here that the absence of concrete and effective steps to prohibit nuclear weapons proliferation and disarmament is one of the greatest threats to international peace and security. Therefore, to reaffirm our shared responsibility of preventing the use of nuclear weapons, their proliferation, and achieving nuclear disarmament, there is need for all states to realize that nuclear weapons have catastrophic humanitarian consequences and should be prohibited. I wish to note that a sound institutional framework will facilitate the successful implementation of the prohibition treaty. I thank you, Mr. President.
I should like to thank the distinguished delegate of Uganda for those words. The conference, I think, has now had the last speaker on this item this morning. We shall continue with the list of speakers and the program announced this morning as from 3 o'clock this afternoon. So, I look forward to seeing you here. I trust you have a good lunch break, and the meeting now stands adjourned.